Hi everyone and welcome back. So in this video we are going to talk about microservice architecture and how we can use the workflow automation tools with the microservices. First of all, why we need these workflow automation tools for the microservices and how we can use them. Okay, so we'll start with a simple example. Let's say there is a PDF processing service and you are using event-driven architecture. Event-driven architecture is nothing but each and every microservice is going to emit an event and will notify the world, okay, I'm done with the processing. Now someone else can take care of this event and can do the further processing. So it's like a PDF processing. We have a start, process, validations, validate the transactions, generate the report, and then finally release the outcome of the PDF processing. This whole flow can be used using different microservices. Let's say for the validation, for the transformation, there can be individual small microservices can be involved, right? If we have many microservices doing the one single business workflow, then these should be decoupled, right? And we are using event-driven. That means a single microservice will do its task and it will emit the event to a message bus or event bus, and then another microservice will pick that item, pick that event from there. So event-driven design can help us in decoupling the services running in a particular fashion, right? Because here we have a fixed set of pattern. We can see we have our system and that system is sending an event, and these are actually nothing but a message brokers, and these are different services. Okay, so for a particular event, these individual services will be responsible for handling that particular event. Okay, so event-driven architecture uses the events to trigger the communications between the components. You emit the events to the message broker, and then a particular microservice who is a consumer of that event will pick that. So it's like a totally decoupled, right? Totally decoupled design. But so our final goal is to help these microservices and orchestrate these microservices so they can talk to each other asynchronously. Orchestration is just defining the behavior in which the microservices can talk to one another. So to help our microservices to work in harmony, we can use a different microservices or the orchestration engine, right? So how they can communicate using event driven, asynchronous, or the request and reply, all these different fashions they can actually talk to one another. So why orchestration engine is needed for this particular task, right? So the main objective is to help our microservices work in harmony. These are the different microservices working for a single business workflow. They will work in harmony. Orchestration engine will route a request to and mediate a particular microservice. It will be able to log and handle that error. It should be fault tolerant and scalable and should be able to care the long running task. So that is the orchestration engine. But that is not what we are going to talk in this video. And there are many orchestration engine available like Cadence at Uber, Conductor at Netflix, and all these things. Okay. Now, here we are talking about the workflow engine, the introduction of workflow engine with the microservices, right? So first of all, what is the use case here? So first we will talk about Kamunda, what it is and how it can help us in solving the different use case. So this was our use case, right? A simple workflow and how we can use Kamunda. So we will be writing some application to make some business process simple end to end. So Kamunda is a workflow engine, or you can say the decision tool for the business processes, which can be automated with the help of microservices. With the increase of number of microservices involved in the different process, the real problem will come out, right? Because what we are doing is we are actually using the workflow engine. We are not using workflow engine and we are using the different set of microservices, and we somehow lost the state of the overall system. In that case, the workflow engine is required. Okay. So we'll talk about Kamunda and how we are going to just resolve this problem with the introduction of the Kamunda, which exposes the REST API interface. And this is like a business workflow we are introducing, right? This is again can go and talk to some asynchronous service. Okay, but with the help of this, we are able to capture the overall state of the system. Okay, This is the PDF has arrived, PDF is being processed, PDF is being validated, transformed, and the final output we are getting, right? So this workflow process, or you can say this workflow tasks are tracked through a different set of microservices. And we are using Kamunda, right? So what is Kamunda workflow automation means? It is a common term, automation, which means it is allows us to separate our the processes, roles through some UI interface, right? So in a simple microservices, we have a lot of tasks, right? And this workflow engine is helping us to automate. What we did is we plugged in all these different requests to these different tasks. Now we have automated. You just invoke this thing from here to here. Rest all these things will work as it is. The only thing is we are getting the overall state. You can actually do the stateful retries. If this particular task is failing, you can do a stateful retry after 5 minutes, 15 minutes, and you can keep retrying these processes even for months, right? You are getting the overall state. You can actually run the long-lived processes. You can run asynchronous integration with these services. Okay, so why should I use BPMN tool, right? So the BPMN is tightly coupled with the two major rules. BPMN allows us to draw our business flow. So this is what I have drawn, our business flow through some modeler, like BPMN modeler. I have drawn this business workflow, right? I can see that in the diagram, and I can see the things running, where it is stuck. I can actually debug the process flow. If there is a failure happening, if there is a timeouts happening, I can handle those specific asynchronous cases. I can do the error handling. I can do the retries. All these things I can do. And Kamunda works. Kamunda comes with this cockpit, the modeler, and all these things. And when we talk about this overall design, this event-driven design. So this was our initial design. Event-driven design, right? So we had these different services. They were talking in the harmony, like you were sending the events to the message broker, and there was some particular service which was receiving it, right? But what was happening is, what is the problem with this, right? Any business change can lead to the change in the all services, right? We don't know the actual state of the services, actual state of the whole system, because the responsibilities is divided into a different services. It's like a decentralized state. We can't collect the overall state of the whole system. Most important, the flow is divided. So there is no way to roll back. If something goes wrong, there is no way, because it's like a decentralized. So what we can do is we can actually use a centralized technique to manage everything from this Kamunda centralized workflow. We have a simple Kamunda which will do the PDF validations, PDF security check, PDF data validations, transformation, and all these things. And we come up with this final approach. Okay. So what advantage we are getting on top of this? You can actually use the Kamunda, ZB, actually that is a workflow engine for microservices. And the only thing is these are able to handle the failures. You'll be able to log something. You'll be able to get the centralized state of the overall system. That is very much important. And ZB is also one of the tool which is also from the Kamunda family, which is actually very popular. And everything is exposed through the REST APIs. So this is a Kamunda engine. Kamunda is an engine is built on top of the Spring Boot and running on simple Tomcat, right? So this is like a BPMN tool and a DMN. You can actually write a DMN tables and all these. You can make all these kind of business decisions based on the data you are getting from your existing state. Okay, so in this particular architecture, we are interacting with the Kamunda using REST interface to start the business process. Defined in the workflow which can be created using Kamunda modeler, right? In this flow, we have to write a custom Java services and adapters. Like these are the custom Java services. This is the external service task. And whenever this will invoke, this needs to be handled by some endpoint of REST service. Okay, this is like a Kamunda modeler. Whenever this process will execute, we can handle it through some external service. That can be the REST endpoint, that can be external service which is handling maybe a PDF validation, PDF extraction, this particular task. Okay, this is the particular service which I wanted to justify why we can use the workflow engine, how we can use and why we should use workflow engine with our set of microservices. Okay, so I mean, in the previous three videos also, I tried to talk about the pitfalls of the microservices patterns and how you can patch in, this workflow engine to a different type of architectures we have. Okay, so we'll talk more about this. We are moving into the workflow engine, which is a Commonda. We'll talk about the modular cockpit and how we can actually how we can actually manage the microservices with the workflow engine. Okay, thanks everyone.